Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Believer's Voice of Victory. Billy Brim's with us today from Prayer Mountain in the Ozarks. She's got some good things for us, so don't miss any of it. Welcome, Billy. We're glad to
have
you.
Thank you very much. And I'm here on a very special assignment.
Praise God.
And that assignment is from the Lord. It's I would say, how you can pray in the end of days, what God needs you to do. And I'm really here on a recruitment, to recruit you to that, at the instruction of the Lord. And last week, I hope you can watch last week. You can watch it on Roku, or you can go to kcm.org and watch what we did last week. Laying a foundation of where we are, how we got to this place in prayer. And we're out at Prayer Mountain in the Ozarks. And we talked about the background of the great move of the Holy Ghost, because we're talking Holy Ghost when we talk pray and work with God.
Yeah.
And so he gave us at the end of 2014, it was our 20-year anniversary really at Prayer Mountain, and this year, and he gave me a new prayer assignment. It's not just for me though, it's for me to share with you. And I wrote a partner letter at the end of 2014, and I'm just going to read you from that partner letter. There's something I left out last week. For some time, the thought came to me that we needed to increase prayer for God to get what He wants in the last days. And the thought of 24/7 prayer kept coming to me. But the question, how to do 24/7 prayer? I knew the need for it. I knew not God needed our prayers. And we have out at Prayer Mountain right now, we have corporate prayer twice a week, Sunday afternoons at 3, and then Wednesday at 12 Central Time, we have a streamed live prayer meeting that's around the world. We have people from around the world, many countries join.
Do you have any idea how many people are praying with you?
Several thousand.
Good.
And we get them from many countries. I'll read some of the countries on
Good.
One of the broadcasts. And they're praying.
That's pretty amazing.
And some of them are archived. They go on archives. Maybe they're sleeping at the time we do our 12 noon prayer in Australia, and so they archive and watch later. But they're joining us. So this is going around in my mind, 24/7 prayer. And these are some of my thoughts. It wouldn't really work to increase prayer out on Prayer Mountain 24/7. Because these faithful prayers already travel distances to come out there twice a week. We're 17 and a half miles out in the boonies. And I knew that we would have, pretty soon we would just have a bunch of tired people. And then I knew that it needed to reach a broader area. It needed not to just be Branson and people out at Prayer Mountain or even our Stream Live prayer meeting. It needed to be a worldwide thing. God needs the church to pray. And He needs us to pray right now. We're going to talk about that later.
Good, good.
So while I'm thinking all this, I got a phone call from Gene Wiseman. You know Brother Wiseman.
Yes, I do.
He's a true prophet of God. So I got one of those Gene Wiseman's phone calls. And the way that God deals, you know, God deals with people in patterns. And the pattern of His dealing with that prophet of God is dreams. So he called me and he told me that he had had 3 dreams in one night. And between each dream, he would get up and pray about it. And then he would go back to bed and he'd have another dream. And in the first dream, Gloria Copeland was in it.
Really?
And she spoke 3 words. Energize the prayers. In the dream, Brother Wiseman says, I knew I was dreaming in the dream. And the thought came to me, I must remember those words. Gloria spoke calmly, he said, as she always does, but there was an unction on that phrase. Energize the prayers. After the dream, Brother Wiseman woke up, got up, meditated on the dream and the 3 words. In the second dream, he saw Ron and Terry Chapman. They're prayer leaders. They're marvelous people of prayer. They used to lead our prayer at Prayer Mountain in the Ozarks. They have now moved to either New Mexico or Arizona, I've forgotten. He said they had a look upon their faces as if they were having to press through something, as if they had to push to get through something. to grab every ounce of their strength to push on. He awoke and meditated on the dream, and he thought of how the people in the first two dreams were associated with me, Billy Brim, and the WWPs, mm-hmm. the Worldwide Prayer, Corporate Prayer. And in the third dream, he saw an especially gifted woman pastor that he'd known for years. And she pastors a church that her father started. And she, too, looked as if she was having to press through something. He said the expressions of the people in the second and third dreams, the Chapmans and the pastor, were so unlike them that he realized that they represented something. And he put it all together, and the Lord made him to know it represents the prayer movement. There's a prayer movement going on now. There's an outpouring of the spirit of prayer upon the body of Christ because God needs us to pray. So Gloria was in the first one, and he knew that she's connected with me. And I think Gloria, thinking back on it, and the Lord changed my subject. You know, I was going to talk about on this broadcast, I was going to talk about the prophet Ezekiel, and he changed my subject, and he told me to do this and to recruit people to pray.
Praise God.
So I think that that first dream that you were in, you were associated with BVOV, Believer's Voice of Victory, and you're associated with me, and you said, energize the prayers.
Praise.
So Brother Halverson looked up, Brother Wiseman looked up those words. Noah Webster's 1828 dictionary, energize, comes from energy. It means to act with force, to operate with vigor, to act in producing an effect. An online dictionary that looked up, remember Gloria said, energize the prayers. Number one, it means give somebody or something energy. Number two, make or become active. So mm-hmm. through this broadcast, we're trusting that you will become active in this. Number three, the third meaning was to supply with electrical power, but we could just say supply with Holy Ghost power. Mm-hmm. I looked in a thesaurus for synonyms, you know, of energize, and I found invigorate, strengthen, boost, galvanize, motivate.
Praise God.
Animate, empower, revitalize, rejuvenate, and pep up.
Pep up.
So.
Those are powerful
I
words.
Believe that when you said in that dream, energize the prayers, it was tied to BVOV. It was tied to my coming here and talking about our new assignment in prayer. And so we're trusting that you will be invigorated, strengthened, galvanized, motivated, animated, empowered, revitalized, rejuvenated, and pepped up to pray.
Pepped up.
And work with God in prayer. The Noah Webster's 1828 definition of energy itself is an internal or inherent power. The power of operating, whether exerted or not. You have a power in you to pray.
Mm-hmm.
As men possessing energy sometimes suffer them to lie inactive. So the whole body of Christ has within it the Holy Ghost. And he's to help us pray. But it is possible to go prayerless. Prayerlessness used to be a great problem in the church. I think God's stirring it up now that we'll not be so prayerless and that we will be energized and we won't let this power that's in us lie inactive. Now listen to what this said in Noah Webster's. Now think of Noah Webster. He was a believer. They wanted him to do an American dictionary of English words. And he said, I will do it if I can rely on the Bible. So often in that 1828
right.
dictionary, he's got Bible examples.
Praise God.
Listen to this, what he's got in a definition of energy. Danger will rouse the dormant energies of our natures into action.
That's right.
We got the Holy Ghost inside us. You look around at this world. You see things. Darkness.
You could say danger quickens us.
It quickens you.
Yeah.
And if you're not quickened right now and you're a believer, you something wrong with you.
You're behind.
You need another dip, bless the Lord, into the baptismal waters, really into the baptism of the Holy Ghost. But, so he needs us now. And what's going on all around us, all what's happening in the Middle East, all the horrors that we see. People beheading, burning people alive.
My goodness, that stirs me up.
It stirs up the Holy Ghost in you. But it can't stir up the Holy Ghost just for you to be mad about it. Mm-hmm. It's got to stir you up for what you can do about
That's
it.
Right.
And there's something we can do about it.
Praise God.
Praise the Lord. Here, I the other day I was praying, and this phrase came to me. It's not come what may, it is come what you say.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not come what may. Oh, the world bad, everything's going to bad. It's not come what may, it's come what you say. And in your own life, it's Mark 11:23. What do you say about things? But also it's what you say in prayer. And we're going to talk about what God needs, and He needs you to pray. And He can say things through you, and it can change situations in the earth.
That's right.
Bless the Lord. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
So, Brother Wiseman told me that every so often it comes upon him, the Spirit comes upon him, he's a prophet of God, that people might be taking the prayer movement lightly. And he said emphatically, the Lord wants the prayer movement to be kept alive. He told me, as nations raise up an air force, I am raising up a prayer force.
Praise God.
So God wants to stir you today as you're watching to be a part of it, to enlist. And Brother Wiseman said to me, you, talking to me, Billy Brim, you have an energy yourself to impart. Continue to do it. So you see, that comes to me, and I talked to you last week about my inheritance and the people of prayer and my background, and I'm going to talk to you this week about prayer warriors that God has encircled us with, really, Gloria, you and me, you know all the ones that I knew. And God wants to, now here's another phrase from Brother Wiseman. There is such light from God coming now, that God wants to bring forth in the midst of death and darkness. There's death and darkness all around in the world. But the light of God, the glory, the light,
yes,
He wants brought forth. And a part of it, Gloria, is what He gets done through people to prayer. Pray.
Is not the glory of God, the presence of God
it
Himself?
Is.
That, and you can see, you see the glory, but you don't always see His presence, but you see the glory. But it is the presence of God.
Yes.
Present now, where we are, you see that glory. You enter into that glory, and that's power.
It's power.
Yes.
And He wants us to pray for that glory.
Amen.
And I'm going to talk about that one
Good.
Day. How He wants us to pray for the glory.
Good. Praise
now,
God.
In energizing you and in enlisting you, like in World War II, they said, Uncle Sam wants you. Now it's the Holy Ghost wants you. God wants you. And so when I was praying about all this, He gave me some orders. Make a 24-hour clock divided into 30-minute pie-shaped segments. Prayer warriors will sign up to pray one of those 30-minute segments. The prayer is to be in the Spirit in tongues.
Ooh, that'll work.
We are to enter this 30-minute segment with no agenda.
That's how we pray beyond ourselves, is in tongues.
Absolutely, Gloria. Did you hear what she said? That's how we pray beyond ourselves.
Yeah,
beyond this noggin here. Gloria, you don't have answers for everything the President of the United States should do.
No, I don't.
You don't have answers for everything the Prime Minister of Israel should do. But the Holy Ghost does.
Right. Praise God. That's
right. And you're the vessel to give Him your tongue. Now, that's what He said to me. These 30-minute segments tell the people this is not the time that they're going to be praying for their family.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This isn't even the time when they say, I want to come and pray for Israel. This is the time when you come and say, here's my vessel, Lord. What do you want said in the earth? Give me utterance.
Yield to the Spirit.
You pray about the mysteries of God. 1 Corinthians 14:2. He that speaks in an unknown tongue speaks not unto men, for no man understands him, howbeit in the Spirit he speaks mysteries. He speaks the plans of God into the earth. God has got plans for this day.
He speaks mysteries that are mysteries to Him.
Yes. Secrets. Plans.
God has things to do.
Woo. God has things to do, Gloria, and He's got to do it through us. There's the bottom line.
Yep.
Now, we are to enter the 30-minute segment with no agenda, no subject of our prayers. That kind of prayer is another time. This prayer will be to offer oneself totally to the Holy Spirit to pray what God once prayed. He has a great need for certain utterances to be made in the earth. He told me, appoint a prayer captain. I knew who it should be, Pamela Tucker, to keep track of the 30-minute segments. You know what I thought the other day?
What?
In the Revolutionary War in America, they had minute men. They could be ready in a minute. We're kind of like 30-minute men.
Yeah. Good.
Pamela Tucker will keep track of the 30-minute segments. The clock will be kept according to Central Time. However, those volunteering from Australia, for example, will advise Pamela of the segment they will pray, and she will convert it to Central Time in America.
Praise
and
God.
For those of us who, because of life's patterns, that's me, cannot keep the regimen of a certain 30 minutes, they can be floaters. I pray different times during the day because I'm sometimes in another time, I'm way around the world.
Sometimes you don't know where you are.
I don't know. And Ken right now, for instance, he's in South Africa.
Yeah.
So that's a totally different time zone. So these floaters just commit to pray 30 minutes a day. They will contact Pamela and advise her that they will, but we do want them to contact Pamela so that we can count how many people are doing it. We have at this taping, I still say taping, recording,
well,
whatever.
Old school.
Yeah, we old school. We have more than 1,000 people signed up. Ooh. And we have them from countries all around the world.
That's awesome, Billy.
But we want to get more. Now, we're not trying to get you for our prayer list. We're not trying to get you for our mailing list. We just want you to call and tell Pamela. You don't even have to leave us your name and address. But just say, my name is Mark Smith from Australia, and I'm going to take in Australia 2 to 2:30 in the afternoon. Then Pamela will put on the clock. She's going to number it. We number how many people are praying in each 30-minute
awesome.
Segment.
That's a God plan.
And you know, the Lord told me, He said, now in those days, when Peter and John went back to, when Peter and John went back to their company, their company was in one little room praying in the Spirit, mm-hmm. probably, because we had the interpretation of their prayer. But the Lord said to me, now your company's all over the world.
That's true.
People who believe like you. People
That's
who
right.
are filled
Glory
with the
to
Holy
God.
Ghost.
That's right.
Now, sometimes, Gloria, here's what I do. Like, I'm going to pray from 30 minutes. So I will purposely start at 12:15, and then I will go to 12:45, and that way I get to play with two different groups around the world.
Yeah.
And sometimes I'm thinking, other people are praying right now. We're up around the throne. And we're not helpless in this world.
That's just an awesome thought.
It's a thought. Yes. So now I know that everybody doesn't do computer. If you do computer, you can go on our webpage and find out about the 24-hour clock. You just go to billybrim.org. And remember, my daddy named me Billy, so my mother said I get to spell it. So she spelled it a little differently.
Did you spell it at birth or did you
She
wait?
Spelled it. Yes, and she spelled it at B-I-L-L-Y-E. brim.org. That's B-I-L-L-Y-E-B-R-I-M.org.
I'm not always misspell your name then.
Yeah, you all probably, a lot of people always misspell my name, but I thought it'd help you out there. B-I-L-L-Y-E-B-R-I-M.org. On the webpage on the right-hand side, you will see 24-hour clock. You click on that. There's a letter from Pamela. Tells you exactly what to do. Now, everybody doesn't do computer.
Why do you look at me when you said that? She looked, did y'all see that? She looked
well,
right
she
at
has
me.
People that does computer for her and they bring her things all the time, you know. But That's not right. everybody has somebody to bring them things off the computer.
Well, this is true.
So anyway, for you, you can call us by telephone in the United States.
Yes, I have a phone.
1-800-972-3447. 1-800-972-3447. Or you can use snail mail. I like snail mail. Post Office Box 40, Branson, Missouri, 65615. The other day, Gloria, I found some letters my husband wrote me.
Did you?
Yes. And it was, and I think letters are marvelous.
I do.
And we miss those letters. And I got him out. I looked at his beautiful handwriting. He always signed the Christmas cards and everything because he had pretty handwriting. I don't. And there he wrote, he was having to work in Pennsylvania because there wasn't any work for him right around where we lived in Oklahoma. And he wrote in that letter, I think of you all the time.
Oh, that's
sweet. Isn't that great? No, he lives in heaven.
He's still thinking about
me. But he's
you.
Still thinking
sure
about
he
me.
Is.
He's in
you
that great cloud of witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
But we like to get snail mail, and you can just write in on your snail mail, Post Office Box, Branson, excuse Missouri, me. And just write in, I'd like to take such and such an hour. If you want to go on our list, and we contact you back, fine, but you don't have to. This is not that. We're not recruiting you for Billy Brim Ministries.
Would it help, Billy, if they wrote on their envelope, prayer clock down in the corner?
Like, yeah, if you so did, if you did, right if you that. Did, it will go right to Pamela. If you, that's a bright idea.
A bright idea. I had a good idea.
And you can just write on the outside one corner, prayer clock. It'll go straight to Pamela because she's not with. She doesn't work for us every single day.
Mm-hmm.
You're exactly right about that. Just write that, and it'll go in. And we want to have. We're not helpless.
No, we're not.
Thank
we're
you.
Glad you're here.
Thank you very much.
We're excited to hear about all this. We want to be totally prepared.
Yes, we do. And be doing what we're supposed to be
and
doing.
And be obedient.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Get God getting use out of us.
That's right.
We've entitled this Praying in the End of Days. What are the end of days? What is that term? It is actually the literal Hebrew for what the King James translates, the latter days. Throughout the Bible, it talks about the latter days. But the really, what the Hebrew says is the end of days. And where does that come from? It comes from, and we're going to put a chart up for you. It comes from what God told Moses. When Moses was given the Torah, when he went up on the mountain, he was given the written Torah, the written word of God, but he was also given the oral word of God. And then he was to give that to Joshua. Joshua gave it to the next one, the next one, the next one. And what he told Moses was that he gave to Adam a six-day work week, 1,000 years being a day, and a day being 1,000 years.
Mm-hmm.
That he had 1,000, he worked in 6 days, and he gave man 6 days to work.
Ah.
And then at the end will come the millennium.
Yeah.
The millennial reign. So these days are divided into three
That's
segments. The first day, day one, 1,000 years, and day two, a yellow and orange, you're seeing there on the chart. And those are called the days of chaos.
Mm. 6 days of chaos?
2 days of chaos.
Two days.
There are 6 days, 6,000 years since Adam.
I'm looking for my
now, you don't have a copy of this. I'll just share right here with you. It is up there on the monitor. But the yellow and the orange is the first 2 days. Those are the days of chaos. Then, on this day came the Torah. Men lived without the written word of God for 2,000 years. Wouldn't that be terrible?
Oh, mama.
And then God gave the law at Sinai, you know, when Moses came up. So the next 2 days are called the days of Torah, or the days of the law. Brown and orange on your chart. And then, according to the prophecy, the Messiah is to come on the fourth day. Well, and then the last 2 days are called the end of days, or the days of Messiah. So we know that he did come, and it's been 2 days. Now it's been 2,000 years that he did come.
Praise God.
And he's coming again at the end of this 6 day. So the latter days, or the end of days, or there's the green and the blue on this chart that you're looking at. 2,000 years since Jesus came, and of course he's coming again. Then when he comes, he'll set up an earthly kingdom, and the purple is a 1,000-year reign of Jesus Christ when he sets up the millennial reign.
Hallelujah.
So we are living in Joel chapter, it talks about the end of days, in Acts it talks about the end of days. And Peter said these signs, he says these are the latter days. Well, he was at the beginning of the latter days, Peter. Now we're at the end of them. So we're right here at the end of days. We're going to be here when an age change comes. And so God is working in these end of days.
We're at the end.
But Satan is working. And so a lot of the darkness that you're seeing in this world is what Satan is bringing forth. He's desperate. He is desperate because he's fighting for his survival. So,
and he's fighting a losing battle.
He's fighting a losing battle. And God's got an army. And we're it.
That's right.
He's got more than one army. He's got angel armies, hailstone armies, army of Israel. But the church is an army of God.
Amen.
And we're the ones with the authority in the earth. At the beginning of the year 2015, you know, the basis of our ministry is a church in Collinsville, Oklahoma. You got this on the next page, Gloria.
Well, help me keep up.
I'm helping you keep up here.
Whiz.
Near the first of the year in 2015, Pastor Lee Morgans is the senior pastor of that church, and my son Chip and his wife are associate pastors. And they presented to their congregation what they call green cards at the Glorious Church Fellowship in Collinsville, Oklahoma. Now, I know the original idea came from Keith Moore, because Chip used to go to Keith's church when he was living in Branson, Faith Life Church in Branson. And what Pastor Keith has the people do in the beginning of the year, and now what they're doing at the beginning of the year in Collinsville, on the green card, I'm just going to tell you about what they've got. On one side of the green, and it's based on write the vision and make it plain. So they want people to write their visions down on paper at the beginning of the year, and then to see how much their faith brought in by the end of the year.
Well, that's interesting.
So on one side of the green card, they have written, what more I can do for God in the upcoming year.
That's good.
That's a whole side. Then on the back side, they divided it into two parts, and the top part is what I need. So that's what you need. Maybe you need a place to live. Maybe you need a car.
Maybe you need something to help you do more for God.
Yes, that's right. Money to help you do more for God.
That's right.
So, what I want. And Brother Keith always encourages the people, and he said, you just write down what you want if money were no object. Just what you want.
Hallelujah.
So you got three divisions here.
That's good.
What more I can do for God in the upcoming year? What I need and what I want. So I'm watching by internet, you know, this church service. It's archived and it's on in the mornings as well live. And I'm watching it, and this thought comes to me, Holy Ghost thought. What does God need? What if God had a green card and he wrote on there, what I need? Does God need anything? Some people think no. I remember seeing a man in Branson wearing a t-shirt. We have a lot of tourists. And it said, God doesn't need me, I need God. Well, that sounds religious, but it's foolishness. It's not true. You do need God, that's for sure. But God needs you too.
That's right. There's a lot of people in the church that have been called but have never answered.
Right.
And God needs all of us.
And God needs them.
That's right.
He needs us. One of the calls that he calls us to is glory. He needs us to put on glory. We'll talk about that later.
Good.
But what does God need? So I went out to Prayer Mountain, and we have a lot of, you know, prayers that come out there every week, and I presented it to them. What does God need? I let them, you know, give forth their ideas. And I remember one woman and where she was sitting, and she said, he needs faith. He needs us to believe, and that is the truth. I see grace like this. I see it like an ocean above us. All the grace of God, all the goodness of God. And it is limited only by your capacity to receive his goodness.
What does God need? Think about Brother Hagin. Here was a sick little boy.
Yes.
And God needed him to to get healed and do what he ended up doing, teaching the word of faith. I mean, he brought that into all the church.
Yes.
God needed him. And
he
did.
Needed that little boy to understand Mark 11:23.
That's right.
And Mark 11:24.
To pass that message on to all of us.
Which is, you have what you say.
That's right.
And the Lord said to me recently, it's not come what may, it's come what you say.
That's good, Billy.
In your own life.
That's right.
It's not, somebody's people, que sera, sera.
Whatever
happens, happens. Whatever will be, will be. But that's not true.
No.
And that brother Hagin that you talked about, he taught us, it's not going to fall on you like ripe cherries off of a tree.
That's right. We got it.
See, that's how grace is.
You have to take it.
You have to. And you, how can you do it? By faith.
That's right.
And I see it like a great ocean above us, a great ocean of all God's goodness,
yes.
All God's grace. You get saved by grace, but what does it say in Ephesians 2:8? By grace are you saved through
faith.
And that not of yourselves, it's a gift of God. God will give you the faith to get born again by.
That's right.
As you feed it and exercise it, then it grows and you can receive more from God.
Right.
I tell you,
there's no limit.
There's no limit.
No limit.
To get His blessings to mankind, and God wants them to have those blessings, He is limited only by man's capacity to receive, and we must receive His goodness through faith. I will never forget hearing Kenneth Copeland. This cleared a lot of things for me. I needed, you know, to know how to pray, because I was brought up in church, and I remember I used to get down and pray by my bedside. I remember one time we needed desperately more money. We had 4 little children, expenses like you have, and I got down to pray for Kent to get a raise. I cleaned up my bedroom, I kneeled down by the bed, and I said to the Lord, "Dear Lord, here's our bills, and we need Kent to get a raise." Here comes this thought. What about the starving children in India? Oh, yes, the starving children in India. Oh, God, how could I be so selfish? Please forgive me. You take care of the starving children in India, and I'll figure out a way to take care of these 4 children. Now that, I thought...
That's pathetic.
Isn't that pathetic? Isn't that pathetic?
Oh, my word.
You see, we have to know how to pray. And I thought, I don't know, surely I didn't think that. It's really rather stupid.
But we didn't know
any. But we didn't know any better. And here I thought, well, somehow it's going to take away from God and the starving children in India.
Take bread out of the children's mouth.
For God to give Kent, probably at that time, a $10 raise. You know? I'm talking back in the 70s.
That's
60s. Actually, 60s.
No,
I'm talking 60s.
Yeah.
Then I heard Kenneth Copeland preach. And he said, God is not moved by need. He said, the devil creates need. And if God was moved by need, then the devil would be leading God around, because he's the one that creates the needs. He's the reason the children are starving in India. Lack of light,
not
darkness.
Because you took
because,
so much money.
Not because I took a $10 raise. See?
Oh, my. Tradition is such a dog, isn't it?
Yes.
Oh, me.
And so I had, the Lord showed me, it was like a black spot back there in my thinking that I had to get out of there by renewing my mind with the Word of God. But when I heard Ken Copeland preach this, God is moved only by your faith. And that's the safe way that God can move. Then that way, we're all on a level here. We can have faith and we can receive from God, and the devil's not leading God around. Yes, you might have a need that the devil created, but the way you get out of that need is you pray whatsoever things you desire.
Yes,
when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them.
And we've proven it.
We've proved it.
Many, all of us have proved
it. So, it's not come what may, it's come what you say. And Brother Hagin taught us Mark 11:23, you have what you say. And Mark 11:24, you have what you pray. But Brother Haggett said this, you can pray it or you can say it. But even if you just pray it, you still have to say it. You still have to keep your mouth in order.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, this is the kind of prayer, the prayer of faith, that works for you and works for your family. And in that one basic prayer book that Brother Hagin's got, he talks about the different kinds of prayer. It's all prayer. But the Bible tells us in Ephesians to be praying with all kinds of prayer. Mm-hmm. It's all prayer, but it has different rules.
Right.
And so there is the prayer that you can pray for the Copeland family, and I could pray for the Brim family, or me, myself, and I, whatever. But there's other kinds of prayer. And there are prayers where I cannot just say, President Obama, we'll do this tomorrow. That'd be witchcraft.
Yeah.
You can't do that. I don't even know what President Obama should do tomorrow. So I have to enter into another kind of praying. The Lord told me, lift up those who are in authority. But for the problems of the earth right now, he needs, what does God need? So here we are, and the Lord presented that to me after the green cards. What do I need? Does God have a need? Yes, to meet your individual needs, he's going to have your faith.
Yes, that's right.
But then it comes to me, God needs a body. He needs a body in the earth. Bless the Lord. And one morning, I got up in the morning praying, and a phrase came to me,
mm-hmm.
floating in, just like that one time when God said to me, it's not come what may, it's come what you say. I'm up in the morning, I'm sitting in my prayer chair, looking out my window, and this phrase comes to me, a body hast thou prepared for me. A body hast thou prepared for me. Mm-hmm. Well, I knew that that's in the scriptures.
Yeah.
But I also knew, because the Lord kept impressing it on me, I knew that another layer of illumination of the meaning of that scripture was coming to me from God. You know, the Jews say this, that a scripture is like an onion. You have its basic meaning, but then you can peel back a layer, and there's another layer beneath it. And you can peel back another layer, and there's another layer beneath it. So I knew that another layer of illumination was coming to me. In its basic meaning, I knew that that verse speaks of the Anointed One, the Messiah. But this morning, as I awoke, God was revealing to me that the church, the ecclesia, is prepared and is being further prepared for Him. A body is being prepared for Him, the church. A body through which He will work, through which He can bring His will, His plans into the earth,
yeah, so
and stop the strategies of the enemy. A body is being prepared for Him. That's us.
A vessel.
And He began preparing that body with the coming of Jesus. And He died His death, burial, and resurrection. He shed His blood. He took His blood before the Father. It was accepted for us. Then He moves to the right hand of the Father and becomes the head over the body, the church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, that original scripture that I was thinking of comes from Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 5. And that's going to be here on page 1 of the body of Christ. You have the body of Christ? Yes. So,
I'm glad to know you're dreaming about me.
Well, it was Brother Wiseman.
Oh.
Yep.
He said that.
Yeah.
Isn't that something?
It is something. But it was affected to me. It was attached
Praise
to me.
Praise God.
But this scripture in the English Standard Version, Hebrews 10:5, reads like this. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, He said, sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me.
Yeah.
Now the King James translation translates it like this. For it is not possible, starting with verse 4, it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. Wherefore, when he comes into the world, he says, sacrifice and offering you would not, but a body have you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, you had no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me. Why did he come?
To do thy will,
O God. Glory. Now, he's quoting Psalm 40, verse 6. Sacrifice, and this is Psalms 40, verse 6. Sacrifice and offering thou did not desire. Mine ears hast thou opened. Burnt offering and sin offering hast thou not required. Then I said, lo, I come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me, I delight to do thy will.
Glory to God. And when
he quoted that in Hebrews, he said, I come to do your will. God has a will.
He has a will
that he needs to get into the earth, but a man has to do it. A person has to do it. Jesus was that one. Now, Lucifer, think of what he did. In Isaiah, it is written, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How did it happen? And then it says, this is how it happened. Because you said, I will ascend into heaven. Mm-hmm. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Those are his five wills. Lucifer was the first to ever cross God's will.
My will will ascend over God's will.
Yes, over God's will.
Yeah, that's what he's saying.
So he came and he was the first one. You're right. He was the first one to cross God's will. God has a will. But then when Jesus came and God prepared a body for him to sacrifice, Jesus said, I come to do your will.
Praise God.
And in his coming to do thy will, then he was the death, burial, and resurrection, the shedding of the blood that allowed God to get a body in the earth.
Yes.
He's the head and we're the body. What's our job? To do God's will.
To do God's will.
And in whatever dispensation you live, your job is to do God's will. That settles it.
That's right.
We are the body of Christ, and we are to do his will in this earth. Now, right now, we're at the end of days.
So when God's calling you to do something, telling you to do something, moving on you to do something, you say, no, I don't want to do that. You're saying, I will not.
You're acting like Satan.
You're joining the wrong crowd.
You know what Brother Copeland says? I'm sure you do, but I'll sit for that.
I've heard a few things. Go ahead.
I like it because he knows he's in the army of the Lord. And he stands at attention and salutes. And he said, I am at your command.
That's right.
We're the body of Christ in the earth.
We are the body of Christ.
Now, he needs us to say things. He needs us to pray things. He said, you're one body. We'll talk more about it.
Of course, the truth is that it's so good when you do what he says, and so low when you try to do it yourself. You know, it's just night and day, good and evil.
And yesterday, we posed a question, does God need anything? And the answer is yes, he needs something. And right now we're centering in on God needs a body. He needs a body in the earth.
That's right. You could say he needs somebody.
Yes, because you know, it's only men that have authority in the earth.
That's right.
And for the Holy Spirit to work, he needs a body to work through. We're his temple. But Satan needs bodies.
That's right.
And that's why he will tempt people to do his ill works.
He'll lie to do it.
He'll lie to do it. He'll trick you.
Deceive you.
Brother Hagin was talking to me one time about how Satan will try to, because he has to have a body to work through, he'll try to get little children he'll like recruit them. He'll make pictures move on the wall, and he'll start showing them even little cartoons with witches and all this and that. And then he can get them off on the evil side of it to use them. But God needs a body.
So who was it that said something to somebody like, you'd say something good about the devil?
Oh, yeah.
Who was that that said
There was this guy who never said anything bad about anybody, and they said he'd say something good about the devil.
He said, well, he is a persistent cuss.
He's a persistent cuss, and I'm telling you, he's not giving up.
No, and neither are we.
And neither are we, and we're the winners. Bless the Lord. God needs a body because it is the body. A body on the earth is a badge of authority.
That's right.
Because you're in the earth, Jesus entered in through the proper door.
Man has authority.
Yes. He came through a body. And we talked yesterday about how the Lord said, a body have you prepared for me? Mm-hmm. He prepared Mary's child for him to carry out God's plan for man.
Right.
But now there's another body God's preparing, and that body is us. Jesus is the head. We are the body.
Amen.
God needs a body in the earth speaking words
taking
that he can
authority.
Clothe with reality.
That's right.
Sustenance. That's the law of creation. You know, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, the Holy Spirit was hovering.
Uh-huh.
What was he waiting for?
Words. Glory to God.
God's words.
Yeah.
And then when he hears God's words, the Holy Ghost, then he can bring about creation. It's the same today.
It's exactly the same in our lives.
Exactly the same. He's hovering over us and what we say. Like I told you yesterday, the Lord said to me in the time of prayer, it's not come what may, it's come what you say.
That's right.
So the Holy Spirit is hovering over me to see what I say about me and mine, but he's also hovering over the body of Christ to bring about God's will in the earth. And God has prepared and is preparing a body to do his work through.
Whatever you hear gets into you.
Sure.
That's why it's so important for people to find a church that preaches the Word of God.
That's absolutely the correct word.
Otherwise, you're not going to be ready if trouble comes.
And the Word and the Spirit.
Yes.
You know, a Holy Ghost
That's
Spirit.
Right.
So the Bible, Jesus was prepared a body for him. He came into the earth. He did the work in the body. And then what he did in the body prepared another body.
That's right.
And that's us.
Praise God.
And it is written in Ephesians 5, 22 and 23, God has put all things under Jesus' feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body.
Mm-hmm.
There's no needing you fussing around about what is his body. The church is his body.
That's right.
The church, which is his body. The ecclesia, which is his body. The assembly, which is his body.
Praise God.
Some people try to divide things up.
Yeah.
Well, there's a Jewish part to the church. There's a Gentile part. Oh, no, there's not.
There's
just
church.
One body. Any Jew, any Gentile can be born again, but then they come in and they're the body of Christ.
That's right.
Or they'll try to divide it some other way, the bride, not the bride. It says right here, the church, which is
his
body.
This
settles it. The fullness of him which filleth all in all. And we see in the Bible, lots in the New Testament, lots about the body. We're just going to read you a few scriptures. Romans 7, chapter 4. It shows the body as Christ is the head, we're the body, but it also speaks of us being married. Wherefore, my brethren, this is Romans 7, 4. Wherefore, my brethren, you also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another. Even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. Marriage is between a man and a woman. And the plan of God is that they bring forth fruit. So that's it with our head, who is also our bridegroom. And we're the body, the bride, and we're to bring forth fruit in the earth.
Praise God.
And one of the fruit that it talks about that gives glory to God is prayer fruit in the book of John.
Praise God.
We are one body. I've just picked a few scriptures. It's all throughout the New Testament. I'm just reading you a few. Romans 12, 4. As we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, but we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another.
Praise
and I thought this was interesting, Romans 12, 1, considering that God is calling us to a certain type of prayer where we sit before him for 30 minutes a day. We offer him our vessel, our body. Look at Romans 12:1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, actually, that says worship, and the English Standard Version, I'm reading you the same scriptures, Romans 12:1. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship.
Praise God.
So, what the Lord is calling us to in a special assignment of prayer that we've been talking about, this is the second week, and you can go online to kcm.org, or you can go on Roku, and you can catch up. He's called us to set aside 30 minutes a day when we present our bodies to Him. And He can use them. And He can present the body that we offer to Him in sacrifice for those 30 minutes. He can use our tongues. And He can speak words in the earth that He wants the Holy Spirit to clothe. The Holy Spirit will give us the utterance, and then the Holy Spirit will bring it about. Our part is we're sitting here and we got a body, the badge of authority. So our part is to present that to Him.
Praise God.
Romans 12:4 says we have, and this is the English Standard Version, for as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. So we, though we are many, we are one body in Christ, and individual members one of another. 1 Corinthians 6:15, know you not that your bodies are the members of Christ? Shall I take the members of Christ and make them the members of an harlot? God forbid. Know you not that he which is joined to an harlot is one body? For two saith he shall be one flesh. We are one with Christ. He is the head and we are the body. 1 Corinthians 10:16, the cup of blessing, talking about communion, which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, being many, are one bread and one body.
Christ.
We are all partakers of that one bread. 1 Corinthians 12:12, as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body are one body, so also is Christ. I am going to skip down to the 25th verse of that passage in 1 Corinthians 12. There should be no schism in the body, but the members should have one, the same care one for another. I was talking to Pastor Sharon Daugherty the other day about unity. Unity in the body. The Lord had been really impressing that upon Sharon. And it says in John 17, Jesus prayed that we would be one, that the glory might show through us. And she'd been thinking along those lines, and I was talking to her about the 30 minutes of prayer that the Lord has called us to do, and how many people around the world are doing it right now.
See if I'm quoting this right. One will put 1,000 to flight, two, 10,000
right.
to flight.
And think all of us all around the world praying.
Awesome. Multiplies it.
Right.
And multiplies the power.
And Sharon said, it's unity. That way we can be in unity.
That's right.
When we're praying, we've offered ourselves to prayer, and there's thousands around the earth, and we're praying 30 minutes in the Spirit. Not only can God get things done, but we're in unity. He can bring the glory forth.
Amen. Yeah.
When we're in unity. And right now at this taping, we've got over 1,000 people signed up for 30 minutes of praying. We've got people from Australia, Canada, Cyprus, the UK, USA, Ireland, South Africa, Nigeria, Belgium, England, Ukraine, Switzerland, Africa, Singapore, Netherlands, British Columbia, New Zealand, Norway, Germany, and the United Arab Emirates and Scotland.
The four corners of the earth.
Yes, hallelujah, praise the Lord. And we have every state in the Union praying, everyone, except for Vermont.
Somebody get busy up there.
Yes, we need to sign up from Vermont. But see, here we are, and we're in unity, and we're the body. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Why does God need us? Because you have to have a body in the earth. And the authority was given to... The body has authority. It was given to Adam. Adam, the devil usurped it from him. But Jesus had a body prepared for him. He came and offered it. Mm-hmm. And through the offering and cleansing of the blood that supplies us, then now we're filled with the Holy Ghost and we're the body.
Praise God.
We're the body of Christ in the earth.
That's
now,
right.
I want to go back to Ephesians. I want to go back to Ephesians chapter 1 and talk about this prayer. This is a prayer that has to do with authority, and it is a prayer that has to do with us being at the right hand of the Father. And it's a prayer, actually, that we pray every day. I pray this prayer almost every day, Gloria. And Brother Hagin's the one that taught us to do this when he was teaching us about authority. And I have it here on my paper, but I want to get it out my little Bible here. You see how these pages have got hand? My hands have been over them. That's because I've been praying over them.
Praise God.
So here's the prayer that you can pray every single day. And it begins in Ephesians 1, 17. God of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of glory, give unto me the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him. Let the eyes of my understanding be enlightened, that I may know what is the hope of your calling, what are the riches of the glory of your inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of your power to us who believe, according to the working of your mighty power, which you wrought in Christ, the Anointed One, when you raised Him from the dead. And when you raised Him from the dead, you set Him at your own right hand in the heavenlies. And you set Him, Jesus Christ, far above all.
Far above. I like that.
Oh, far above.
That's a good position.
All principality, power, might, and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And you put all things under His feet, and you gave Him,
hallelujah,
to be the head over all things to the church, which is His body. He's the head. We're the body. Where are the feet? They're in the body. So everything's under our feet.
But what's in the body?
Yes.
Fullness.
Fullness of Him.
That's right.
That filleth all in all. Now, don't stop at chapter 2. Paul didn't when he was writing this. And you has He quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins. Go to verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love wherewith He loved us, even when we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with the Anointed One. When He quickened Christ, when He quickened the Messiah, when He quickened Jesus, He quickened you and me, made us alive.
Amen.
He quickened us together with Christ. By grace we are saved.
Hallelujah.
And He raised us up together. And He made us sit together in the heavenlies in Christ Jesus.
Praise God.
When He quickened Jesus, He quickened the body. When He quickened the head, He quickened the body. When He quickened Him, He quickened us. When He raised Him, He raised us. When He seated Him, He seated us.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Now, God needs us to know this. And I want to read you, this is called Authority.
That's right.
And I want to read you from this book, Authority of the Believer, by John A. McMillan. Brother Hagin wrote in his front of his book, The Believer's Authority. He said it's this man that his writings that inspired Brother Hagin.
What page are you reading?
I'm reading on just a little forward part here.
Okay, forward.
And Mr. McMillan says, he was a missionary to Philippines and to China. He knew a lot about the demonic world. He said, the rapidly approaching end of the age is witnessing a tremendous increase in the activity of the powers of darkness. He died in 1956. We see the powers of darkness.
1956.
We see them increased even more.
Yeah.
That's why everything's crazy all over this world. It's the powers of darkness.
Just think of one arm of that is drugs. Think about how many more drugs
yeah.
are out there driving people crazy.
Even since 1956 when he died.
Yeah. Think about that.
Yeah, right. To meet the situation, the Church of Christ needs a new conception of prayer. We're talking about praying in the end days. You're going to pray in the end of days, you need to know about the prayer that you offer in authority. That's one of the kinds of That's praying. Right. The urgent call is for men and women wholly yielded to the Lord, whose eyes have been enlightened to see the ministry in the heavenlies to which they have been called. Such believers may, in union with the great head of the body, exercise an authority to which the powers of the air must give place wherever challenged. So we're sitting up there. I'm reading from this book now, Gloria. You don't have it there on your paper. But you got this book, and I know you do it. Yes. So here's praying in the last days, praying in the end of days. You need to know that when Jesus was raised, you were raised. You were seated at the right hand of the Father. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Christ, I'm reading you now from Macmillan. Christ and his people were raised together. When he raised him from the dead, you were raised from the dead.
You know, when Brother Hagin preached to authority the believer, and we heard it, it changed everything.
It changed everything.
It changed everything. It changed, it gave us our healing, it gave us prosperity, our needs. It just changed everything.
Absolutely. Just by you knowing you're up there at the right hand of
Christ.
He says here, the reviving of Christ expresses also the reviving of his people.
Yes.
The very act of God, which raised the Lord from among the dead, also raised his body.
Amen.
Head
translated us
and
out.
Body are naturally raised together.
That's right.
Christ the head, his body the church, the assembly of believers.
Thank you, Jesus.
In this, the believer with the ascended Christ to the heavenlies is made a partaker of Christ's throne. That there may be no misunderstanding of the Holy Spirit's meaning in this presentation of the truth, the elevation of the Lord's people with their head. They are made to sit with Christ in the heavenlies. Christ's seat is at the right hand of God. His people, therefore, occupy with him the same august position.
That's right.
This honor is not to a chosen few, but is the portion of all those who share the resurrection of the Son of God.
All those born again.
It is the birthright of every true believer, of every born again child of God. They are seated at the right hand of God, and the right hand of the throne of God is the center of power of the whole universe. The elevation, I'm continuing to read, the elevation of his people with him to the heavenlies has no other meaning than that they are made sharers of the authority which is his.
That's right.
They are made to sit with him to share his throne.
Oh, and we have his name.
Hallelujah.
That's how we exercise that
That's
authority.
That's how we exercise
we
it.
We have his name.
We have his name.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus, from the right hand
That's
of the
right.
Father, we speak.
Glory to God.
To share a throne means to partake of the authority which it
Praise
represents.
You, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
We have been, indeed, we have been elevated in the plan of God that we may now exercise to the extent of our spiritual apprehension authority
yeah.
over the powers
Amen.
Of the air and over the conditions which those powers have brought about on the earth and are still creating through their ceaseless manipulations of the minds and circumstances
we
of
command,
mankind.
We command the sickness to go.
Because it's of the powers
we
of the air.
We command the healing to come. We command poverty to go. It's a curse. We command money to come. It's an awesome thing to have the name of Jesus.
Oh, right. And he needs you, Gloria, to know that.
That's
he
right.
needs you to know that.
And you need to know it.
Yes, and we need to know it. And then if we believe that God quickened us together with Christ and raised us up together, on page 27, he says, our reaction to it should be, I accept your gracious
yes.
word.
Oh, yes.
I believe you've thus wrought
Glory
for me.
Glory to God.
In humble faith, I take my seat at the right hand of the Father, and I do it. I do it in the mornings every day.
Praise God.
Most every day, I sit in a seat, and I say,
you take authority.
I take authority. I tell Satan that day, you are not coming in this realm. You're not coming in Billy Brim's family. You're not coming in the good works
That's
that I've
right.
been ordained to walk in.
Amen.
And take my authority. God needs me to do that.
You
know
need
that
to
he's
do
done
it.
All he's going to do about the devil?
That's right.
He's done all he's going to do.
Right.
So what does he need his body to do? He wants his body free from the darkness.
So we command the sickness to go.
Yes,
we
have authority.
We command the money to come.
Yes.
We command the devils to get off our children or whatever's in our family needs deliverance.
And God needs
authority.
That.
That's
he
the
needs
authority
it.
Of the believer.
He needs you
it
to do it.
It changes everything.
He needs you to resist the devil,
that's
and the
right.
devil will flee
you.
From
resist
you.
The devil and he flees. So you need to become bold. You say, well, I just don't know how to do that. Well, you can find out. Get these books, get other things, go to the Bible, get good teaching tapes. First of all, look under things that say authority of the believer. That changed everything in our lives. Poverty went out the window.
The body of Christ.
Sickness went out the window.
The body of Christ has authority in the earth.
Amen. It does. And we take it in Jesus' name.
I'm here on assignment. And the assignment is a recruiting assignment to the body of Christ to work with God in these last days
yes,
in prayer.
Yes, amen. Amen.
And Gloria, I never considered myself a great prayer. I ran around with great prayers, and sometimes they made you feel like Ned in the first reader.
Yeah.
But I got an assignment from God to help the prayers. And one of the men that we ran around with, you and I and all of us, was Brother Philip Halverson. Mm-hmm. And he's one of the ones that God gave me the assignment through. He is a part of the package this week, and I want them to play right now just an example
good.
Of a meeting we had in 1983. Brother Hagin prophesied to me.
This he was said, the olden days.
This was. He said, the people that you know, that we know, he knew them well, who are prayer warriors, seasoned prayer warriors, pray in another realm. They're going to start going on. And if you don't get what they have out of them, we're going to lose it, the next generation. So here's one of those men. I had a meeting in 1983. We gathered these people together. And here's Brother Philip Halverson and his wife, Fern.
Praise
and
God.
He's one of the ones that prayed on that high level. I want you to watch him before we go on.
Okay, good. That'll be interesting.
But in the nighttime, these things will happen. As I begin to intercede, I wake up, I'll be praying in tongues, praying, and I'll begin to pray out in the language of my understanding, words of wisdom and knowledge, of things I just hear as I speak. And honey, share a little about what happened in the system.
I remember so well, one night I was in a deep sleep, and I was startled and awakened by this loud utterance that my husband was uttering in tongues, and a very forceful. This happens regularly, but this particular night, I heard him speak in English. The words, do you recall the words that you said? You said, Donald Oman, in Jesus' name, life come into your body. You said you had work to do. The Lord wants you to finish your work. Life come into your body. Now, we didn't know a Donald Oman. Have any of you ever heard of a Donald Oman? Well, we didn't. And Phil continued this on for several minutes. And then we worshiped the Lord and held up with our understanding also whoever this Donald Oman was. We spoke life. We continued to praise the Lord that he was going to live, whoever he was. Now, most of the time, the experiences we have no knowledge of whatsoever. The names or situations or government officials or government or national situations or nations, we don't know. We soon find out maybe the next day or the next week as the Lord brings it forth, and then everybody knows. Or most people know, but at the time we have usually no knowledge whatsoever in our understanding. So we worshiped the Lord, thanked the Lord that the Spirit had taken hold for this Donald Oman, and we went to sleep and we woke refreshed the next day, as we always do, even if we spend a whole night in prayer. When we hit the pillow and we sleep for maybe an hour or so, we awake refreshed the next day, as if we'd slept for a whole day.
Amen. After this had happened, I heard what I was speaking. I knew the tremendous anointing of the Holy Spirit. The anointings come in, how would I say it? In greater measure at times. There's times you feel almost like you were saying this morning, you're almost going to be raptured. And I wonder, what's going to happen next? And the intercession comes. And you lift up. And I wondered about this. And you know, in the natural, you're so curious, you're wondering, this mind up here wants to know what's happening down here. It wasn't until about 6 months later, I was in a church one Sunday morning, and they were handing out the prayer requests. And as this lady gave me a sheet, I looked at it, and halfway down the sheet, I saw the name Donald Ullman. I hurried back to her. I said, do you know who this is? She said, yes, I do. His mother-in-law is in the morning service. I hurried down to see her and talk with her, and I found out that Donald Ullman had been a missionary over in Lebanon, at an orphanage over there. He'd been very ill. And these are some things of the Spirit I don't understand. Minister could come, anointed him with oil, prayed for him. People had prayed for many different churches there. He'd become ill, and so much had happened, and he coughed up so much, the doctor said, there's no way he can live. And he'd called his wife, and they said, you just be there, and this is the day he's going to go, he's going to die. And he had died. But you know, that late,
he did that.
Yes, but they wanted to bury him. His wife was really
off. Yes.
Holding on. And in the night hours, the Lord looks for an intercessor. And as you will yield to that Spirit, and as you will speak those words, the Holy Spirit gives you. For I spoke life to that body. I spoke healing. I called him back to finish the ministry God had called him to do. He came back to the States. I met him, talked with him. He was well. He lived for 13 more years and built a big church. And then one day he just slipped away to be with the Lord. But these experiences didn't just come one at a time. They came as a flood into our life.
When Brother Halverson was talking, and that was 1983, Donald Ullman had died. He was dead. He was in Lebanon dead. And they were even thinking of burying him, but his wife was just holding on. But back in Minneapolis, Minnesota, or St. Paul, there was God moving upon someone to pray. Now, God needed a person in the earth to pray. He needed a person in the earth to say that.
Yeah.
And Brother Halverson was one of those kinds of prayers who's ever on the line and moving at the urging of the Holy Ghost. There are lots of things that God sees happening in the earth, and He searches for someone to pray. And in the end times here, He's going to really raise up some prayers again, even on the line and in the category of Brother Halverson, some of the others on our, Rachel T. Fittiller, the others that are in our package that we're offering. Now, these people, they surrounded me in my life. I had my heritage of the Pickard family that were in prayer. I came to work for Brother Hagin. Mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness, Brother Hagin. When he would pray, he would kneel down often by a chair, side of a chair at the end of a service, and he would have a conversation with God. Prayer is a conversation with God. It's two-way. You should hear as well as speak. He heard Donald Ullman, and he said it. So you should hear as well as speak. And the Lord in my life has given me an assignment to help the prayers. That's why I'm here. That's why I'm talking about the 24-hour clock. That's why I'm talking about the 30-minute segments. And the first time I heard the phrase, help the prayers, it happened like this. And I have it in my book, The Road to Prayer Mountain. It was 1981. And I had worked for Brother Hagin for 10 years, but at this time I was not working for him. I was attending his summer camp meeting. I'm sure you and Ken were there. Ken was a speaker. And I was in Tulsa, Oklahoma, going to the camp meeting. And going to the camp meeting, it lasted all day long. Morning, noon, and night were our sessions. And there were Holy Ghost sessions, so they lasted a long time. Saturday morning, I got up, and I had an appointment to speak Saturday night in Minneapolis, Minnesota in a camp meeting. Not Mac and Lynn's, but this was before that, 1981. And so I got up Saturday morning at 7:30, had a flight out to from Tulsa to Minneapolis, got there, and I was so sleepy. I went to my hotel room and I laid down to bed and I said, Lord, I'll wake up at 3 o'clock and I'll get ready for the meeting. The meeting was in that hotel in the basement. I'll get ready for that meeting tonight. So I went to sleep, and at exactly 3 o'clock, I sat straight up and I could still see the dream vision that I'd had while I was sleeping. In my dream, I seemed to watch the proceedings, a proceedings in which I took a part in them. There was a great house, and in the great house, there was going to be a wedding. And I knew it was the wedding of Christ and his bride. I could not see the bridegroom, but I sensed him. Mm-hmm. And I sensed the activity. Everybody was hurrying about, scurrying about, and they were preparing for the wedding supper of the Lamb, which we will take part in heaven. But we were on earth. This proceeding was on earth. There was an armchair there. I was seated in the armchair. I had my leg up over that one arm, and I was in ecstasy watching all the proceedings. I knew everyone had a part, and I thought that my part was just to, like, daydream of the ecstasy of the wedding. Over there to my left, there was a door. The door opened. A man came out and he said, come help us prepare for the wedding. I said, oh no. I thought they were cooking. I thought they were preparing the food. I said, that's not my part. Everybody has a part. That's your part. My part is here just to take this in, just to daydream. He came to the door the second time. Come help us get ready for the wedding. I said, no, that's not my part. Preach him a little sermon on everybody doing their part. He went back in there. The third time he came out, and he was crying. He said, please help us come get ready for the wedding. I was translated from my chair where I was observing back into that room. They were not cooking as I had supposed. They were unwrapping gifts. They were unwrapping the gifts of the bride, which I gave them another sermon. I said, that's not your part. You're not supposed to unwrap the gifts of the bride. The bride's supposed to unwrap the gifts. But then I had an overwhelming desire to see what they were getting. Every gift was wrapped in a package, a man-sized package, a box, tall with a bow on the top of it. And these people were unwrapping, they were unswishing the bows, and then down would come the paper, the box would open it, and inside was a garment, some clothing. And they were taking them out, and they were hanging them on a rack. And they were the colors, earth tones. They were brown, orange, green, yellow. They hang them up there. And then I woke up, and the Holy Spirit was interpreting to me the dream. And he said, those people are the prayers, and those gifts represent the gifts of the Spirit and the ministry gifts of Christ. Mm. He said, you have never seen them operate like I designed them to operate.
Oh, Jesus.
You have never seen apostle, prophet, pastor, evangelist, teacher operate like I intend them to operate. You have never seen the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the power gifts, the utterance gifts. You have never seen them operate like they're designed. The operation that you have seen has fitted the church for her earth walk. That's why they are earth colors. But look over there. And I looked over there, and there were boxes. They were in a shimmering paper. They had gossamer bows. Mm. And they unwrapped that, and down came the sides of the box, and inside was a garment made up of glory. Mm. And he said, these gifts are God's gifts to the church, and they are designed for her before you leave. Shortly before the marriage supper of the Lamb, the church will don glory. The church will put on these glorious garments. And she will have a walk just before Jesus comes when she will be adorned in glory.
Praise God.
And she will minister, the apostle, prophet, pastor, all of them will minister in the glory. And the gifts of the Spirit, healings and miracles, will operate in the glory. Now he said, these gifts are in people. And he said, the prayers, they have to be unwrapped. And the prayers have to do with that. The prayers have to do with the praying in of the glory of God. And he said, you are assigned to help the prayers. And that's the first I heard that term, help the prayers. Now, Brother Halverson, he went to heaven in 1985. I had that vision of the Marriage Supper of the Lamb in 1981. In 1983, Brother Hagin had prophesied to me, you have to get these people together and get out what they know, because if you don't get out what they know about prayer, we're going to lose it. So that little clip you saw at the beginning, that was 1983, and that was Brother Halverson praying. You saw just a sample of his praying the will of God. Brother Halverson went to heaven in 1985. My sister went to heaven, my only sister, went to heaven on a Friday in 1985. Well, Thursday or Friday. And on Saturday night, Brother Halverson called me. I was at my mother's house. There was all the family there, you know. And Brother Halverson talked to me for 1 hour and 45 minutes on the phone Saturday night. And he said to me, in May, or it might have been the first day of June, he said to me, Satan's trying to make you stop.
Mm.
He said, the attack against your sister was an attack against you. Mm. She didn't know quite how to stop it. She was only 42. But he says, Satan is trying to make you stop. He said, you have no idea how important it is to the Holy Ghost that you don't quit.
Mm.
You do not quit. And he talked to me for an hour and 45 minutes. And he said, never forget, your number one assignment is to help the prayers. My husband died 10 months after that. But I always knew, don't quit.
Don't quit.
But the amazing thing was, Brother Halverson went to heaven the next day. He talked to me 1 hour and 45 minutes on Saturday. On Sunday, at Mac and Lynn Hammond's church, I think it was June 2nd, Brother Mac Hammond called him up to pray. Brother Halverson prayed. And when he prayed, the Holy Ghost would come on him and he'd shake. And Brother Mac had given his vision, of a new vision God had given him, and he called up Brother Halverson to pray. Brother Halverson, Mrs. Halverson, you saw her, Fern. Mac and Lynn, they were praying up on the platform, and they fell out under the power, Mac and Brother Halverson.
Mm.
And Brother Halverson smiled. And they just all thought that he fell under the power. This was Sunday night. And but he was gone.
He left.
He left. Brother Hagin said he just got so far out there, he didn't get back.
Oh, glory to God.
They no known cause of death. They did autopsy, no known cause of death. Now, that Saturday night, he talked to me that night. Okay, we had my sister's service the next day.
So his spirit left his body.
His spirit left his... No, but now Saturday night, he talked to me on the telephone. The next day is Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And on Sunday night, he is going to heaven. And on Sunday morning, I was with my sister's family, and then I drove home 40 miles to my home in Collinsville, and the phone was ringing, and it was from Mac and Lynn's church. And here was this high music going, high worship and praise. And Brother Halverson had gone home, they called me.
Mama.
And it was like when Elijah went home. You know, he was they were worshiping God. There was no better place that he could have gone home from. But he said to me, now, also, on that Saturday, when he talked to me, he talked to Lynn Hammond, and he gave Lynn Hammond his prayer assignments.
passed
Now
it on.
We know that he did it. We didn't know what he was doing. But he took Mac and Lynn out that Saturday, and he passed over his assignments to her, and he said to Lynn, don't ever stop praying for Billy Brim.
Hmm.
And then he mentioned another person as well. He said, it's important to God that she not quit. So everything that's happened,
isn't that amazing,
with Prayer Mountain in the Ozarks, and now we have Prayer Mountain in the Ozarks, and we're having Prayer Mountain in the Galilee, every bit of it that has happened has to do with an assignment to help the prayers, because God needs the prayers to pray in the plans of God. He needs the prayers to pray in the glory.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
That glory that they're going to walk in. And that's why he has said to us, and we're going to talk more about that tomorrow. That's why he has said to us at Prayer Mountain, and he showed me, he's got to have us. Gloria, I know, and I don't want to say how I know.
Okay.
But there are some things that the enemy has planned against us. Against the United States.
Against the United States.
And I know that we have until the end of the year, until 2015, to keep them from happening. And God needs us to pray. The Lord made us to know that if the church will pull together in prayer and even repent for our nation, then these things can be staved off. It's not come what may. It's come what we pray.
Oh my.
It's come what we say. And the Lord is, He wants us now to pray together in united prayer so that He can cause these things to stop. He can't just do it without us. He is the head, we are the body, we are in the earth. It's my job, it's my God-given job. You said that you didn't like it so much when He had you to preach. This is not what I would have picked, helping the prayers. I'd rather teach. I'd rather take my hanky and dance and sing in the glory of God. But He gave me the assignment, help the prayers. And so when I was going to teach on this session, on one of the prophets, which I love to do, Elijah and what's coming, I mean Ezekiel and what's coming, he said, no, you talk about prayer and you help recruit prayers that the body of Christ can be praying together in unity at this time.
Praise God.
God has to have something. He's got to have a body. He's got to have it in the earth.
Yes.
Praying.
Yeah.
To stop the strategies of the enemy and to pray in the plans of God. As to stopping the strategies of the enemy, when we went to Prayer Mountain in the Ozarks and he told us to and it's now 300 acres out in the boonies.
Mm-hmm.
But when we established it as a place of prayer, I just happened to look in this book and what he told me. For two purposes. Number one, pray in the plans of God, and we're going to talk about that today. But he also said to stop the strategies of the enemy. And you know what he said to me? There didn't have to be an Oklahoma City.
Oh.
At that time, what had happened, the Murrah building in Oklahoma City had been bombed by,
yes,
I think his name was Timothy McVeigh, you remember?
Uh-huh.
Brought in a load of explosives.
Mm.
And he said to me, there didn't have to be an Oklahoma City.
Oh, yeah.
So things can be stopped that the enemy has planned.
Amen.
But it's going to take the church working with God in saying and praying. And really, for something like this, you don't know there's going to be an Oklahoma City. You can't just use your faith and say, well, no, Timothy McVeigh won't come. You don't know.
You have to hear words.
You have to hear God. You have to pray in tongues and in the Spirit. And that's why we're getting people recruiting you this week.
Yes, amen.
To sign up and commit yourself for 30-minute praying in tongues. That's what the Lord told to me. He showed me a clock, a 24-hour clock, and He said, divide it into pie-shaped pieces and get people to commit themselves to pray for 30 minutes, a certain 30 minutes, or to be floaters And they can pray at any time during the day. But that way we'll have thousands of people all around the earth praying. This is not the kind of prayer, if any two of you agree. Well, it's not that kind of a prayer. You have that kind of a prayer. It's one of the kinds of prayer. And in Brother Hagin's book, you're going
to
see.
You have some supernatural knowledge.
This one is higher than that.
Yeah.
It's not just for your healing or my healing or prosperity. This is something in the earth. God wants to stop 9/11.
Amen.
God wants to stop a terrorist. So he can use, he wants to stop. They were ready to bury Donald Oman like yesterday, dead. But Brother Halverson sat up and Brother Donald Oman was over in Lebanon. But Brother Halverson, God found him. He had one that would pray. And he sat up in bed and said, Donald Oman, you will live and not die.
Praise God.
See, he needed those words spoken.
The supernatural.
The supernatural. Mm. Now, stop the strategies of the enemy. Pray in the plan of God. There are three groups of people, the Jews, the nations, the church. The church is the body of Christ. He's got a plan for us before we leave here to walk in the glory.
Amen.
A glorious church. Hallelujah.
And the lighter it gets, the more critical it gets.
The more critical it gets. So I want you to turn to the book that tells us all about the glorious church. And that's the book of Ephesians. And in the book of Ephesians, in chapter 5, verse 25, I have it down on the paper, but I like to look in my Bible. Praise the Lord. Ephesians 5 and verse 25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, King James says. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to read that in NASB and all other translations say, gave himself for her.
For her.
Because that's what it is. So that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church. A glorious church filled with the glory of God.
Yes, amen. No spots.
Not having a spot or wrinkle or any such thing. But that she should be holy and without blemish.
Amen.
And in this passage, it shows us he's the bridegroom. We're the bride. He's washing us with the water of the word. The Eastern brides were washed. Read about Esther washed. And they had oils put on them. And they were prepared. But he's prepared us with the washing of water of the word. So that he might present us to himself. There is a marriage supper of the Lamb. We will be presented to him. And he is the most glorious bridegroom there was. And we are the most glorious bride. So shortly before Jesus comes, I don't know how long it's going to be, Gloria. I don't know if it's going to be 10 minutes, 10 days. I don't know, 10 hours. But there's going to be a time when this church is absolutely walking in the glory.
Praise God.
And donning the glory. And it's happening right now. It's happening right now. It's happening at Eagle Mountain. It's happening at other places. So on here telling us about this, it says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 30, we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. And verse 32, this is a great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. It is a great what? A great mystery. Now, what do we find in 1 Corinthians 14, chapter 2? He that speaks in an unknown tongue speaks not unto men, but unto God. No man hears him. Howbeit, in the Spirit, he speaks mysteries. In the New Testament, this Greek word mysterion, it means secrets. And in fact, it's usually used in the common usage of the day for divine secrets. God has some divine secrets. He has some mysteries. They are identified in the Word of God as mysteries. In 2 Thessalonians, he talks to us about the mystery of iniquity, meaning the Antichrist. In Romans 11, he talks to us about the mystery of Israel. So he has plans for Israel. He has, He wants to and he will orchestrate things that have to do with the iniquity, and he's going to settle that mystery of iniquity. There are other things called mysteries in the New Testament, but one of the ones always identified as the hidden mystery is the mystery of the church, the body of Christ. In the Old Testament, sometimes the prophets made prophesies about it, but they didn't know what it was talking about. Mm-hmm. It was hidden.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It was hidden in God. There was a mystery concerning a body that God was going to raise up.
But the time had not yet come.
The time had not yet come. And in fact, Gloria, the mystery of the church, the mystery of the body of Christ, is not in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It's not there. We see Jesus in his earth walk.
Mm-hmm.
We see him then start talking in John chapter 14. He starts talking about a new day. But it took that Apostle Paul, and he went away. You can add up the years in Galatians chapter 1. He went away for 17 years. And God revealed to him the mystery of the church. And it is the mystery of the body. You could read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you think you could get it because you've read the rest of the Bible. You think you could understand, but you couldn't. Hmm. Nowhere in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John do you see that he's going to raise up a body. And he's going to be the head of the body. And the body's going to be in the earth and have the authority. But positionally, he is seated Christ at his right hand, the head. And the body is seated with him positionally. He's the head, we're the body.
That's right.
And Brother Hagin always said, the head and the body, they go by the same name.
That's good.
You're the body of Christ, and you've got access to his name.
Amen.
You married Kenneth Copeland, you've got access Kenneth Copeland's name. And we have access here in the earth to the name of Jesus.
Praise God. That's right.
And in the name of Jesus, from our position here, we then are to speak and to pray God's will into the earth.
Take authority.
Take authority. Now, one of the best places about this mystery is Colossians 1:26. And he says there, in that, he says, I speak to you the mystery, the hidden mystery. I didn't mark that, but I'm going to get it here. Colossians 1:26. Paul is revealing the mystery, and he writes, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would or wills to make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the nations, the Gentiles, which is, here's the mystery, Christ
in you,
the
praise God.
Hope of glory.
Jesus.
When we're born again, he comes into us, our hope of total glorification.
Mm-hmm.
And as we look in the Word as though it's a mirror, the Holy Ghost changes us from one degree of glory to the next, one degree of glory to the next. And as you said on an earlier broadcast, the glory of God is the presence of God. So each born-again believer has the ability to manifest God's glory. Now, we're talking about prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And we're talking about getting glory into the earth. Now, it's the last days. Turn to Romans 26. And we're talking about the glorious church, and we're talking about prayer having a part to do with God's glory.
What chapter would it be?
Romans chapter 8 and verse 26. I think I said wrong. Thanks for correcting me.
8:20. Well, I don't get to do that very often.
Praise the Lord. Now, Romans 8, what a wonderful chapter it is. Marvelous chapter. Now, just to show you that this talking about the end of days and what we call the end of days, the Bible calls, look at what it says in verse 17. It tells us that we're children of God and we're heirs, mm-hmm. heirs of God, And we're joint heirs with the Anointed One,
amazing,
with Christ. And if it so be that we suffer with Him or endure with Him this life here on the earth, we will also be glorified together. You are headed for complete glorification.
Thank you, Lord.
I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory presence of God, which shall be revealed where? In us.
Glory to God.
In this church in the earth, this body of Christ, it's going to come forth into glorification before we leave here. And now he says, even creation is crying out for this. For the earnest expectation of creation waits for the manifestation
of the sons of God.
Of the sons of God. The trees. They drop their fruit and it rots on the ground. Their leaves fall off in the winter. The flowers, even the little pansies that are so strong, they droop finally. Mm-hmm. And he says, creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. Creation was made subject to vanity, not willingly. This is a parenthetical.
Sin.
Yeah, sin
that.
Did it.
And righteousness will change it.
Yes.
When that time comes.
But look at verse 21. Creation itself shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption. There will come a day when the fruit will rot.
Yes, glory to God.
Creation itself will be released from the curse, you might say.
Mm-hmm.
From the bondage of corruption into what? The glory. The glorious liberty of the sons of God, the children of God.
Yeah.
Look at verse 12. We know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. This whole creation is groaning. The earth is cracking. They have earthquakes. They're having this and that. It's groaning and travailing. But not only creation. Verse 23, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves. And that's a part of travail and prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body.
Redemption of our body.
For we're saved by hope. Hope that is not seen is hope that is seen is not hope. We still have the hope of total glorification. Verse 25, but if we hope for that which we see not, then we do with patience wait for it, and likewise, what does likewise mean? In the very same way, in the very same manner. In the very same manner what? Back up to verse 22. Creation is groaning and travailing for the glory. And verse 26, likewise, in the same manner, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, also helps our infirmity. King James has a plural there, but it's not. It's only one infirmity. And it tells you right away which one it is. The Holy Spirit helps our infirmity. Here it is. We know not what we should pray for as we ought with our heads, our noggins. We don't know exactly how to pray in this glory.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it's talking about, the glory, the glorification. We don't know exactly how to pray it in, but the Holy Spirit, but we will pray like creation's praying with groanings and travails. Mm-hmm. We know not. The Holy Spirit helps our infirmity, for we know not what we should pray as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groanings, which cannot be uttered, and the Greek means inarticulate speech. Tongues, travail, That's why God is asking us now for 30 minutes. 30 minutes of our day in which we don't have an agenda, but we give ourselves to Him. And He's going to be using that time, and He's going to be giving us utterance to pray in the plans of God.
Praise God.
And the plan of God for the church is the glory,
glory
and glorification.
Amen.
And many days when you sit there and you're praying, and people from around the world are praying, He's going to use us to pray in the glorious church.
Praise God.
And the glory of God.
You know, this scripture, 28, it's tied in with that intercession.
Sure it is.
Because we know that all things that are happening is not for our good.
You got it.
But it says, all things work together for them that love God and to those who are called according to His purpose. So in the intercession of the will of God,
yes,
the will of God is all things work for our good.
Good.
Yeah.
And what did He say to Moses when Moses said, "Let me see Your glory"? He said, "Let my goodness pass before
yeah.
you."
Oh, Billy, that is great.
I just now got that. Praise God.
Ooh, that is so good.
So this prayer, the Holy Spirit helps us make intercession with groanings which cannot be uttered. It's working together for the glory. And He that searches the hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit. I don't know the mind of the Spirit. But He does, and He lives in me.
That's why speaking in tongues is so important.
Absolutely.
Because we bypass our mind and what we know in the natural and get into the Spirit, and we pray the perfect will of God.
Absolutely.
And bring these things to pass that God desires to happen.
Absolutely.
Glory to God.
Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. And that's the prophecy that we've been reading that Brother Hagin, God gave through Brother Hagin. I misplaced it right now, but He spoke to us exactly through that prophecy that when we get our tongues hooked up to our spirits and the Holy Spirit, here it is.
See, we pray beyond our knowledge.
Yeah. Speaking by the Spirit, not just speaking words out of your own mind or thinking, but speaking by the Spirit, words that are inspired by the Spirit of God, words that well up from within you out of your spirit, given to you by the Holy Ghost.
Oh, glory to God.
Those words spoken boldly bring forth great happenings. That's what He's asking us to do. The Holy Spirit will help us make the utterances that will bring forth the happening the glorious church.
That's right, Billy. That's right. That's awesome.
It's awesome.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Praying in other tongues is so vital to bringing the plan of God to pass.
Because
we bypass what we know with our head up here. In the Spirit, we speak what?
Mysteries.
Glory to God. And those mysteries come to pass.
And that's what He's trying to get
to
come to pass
do.
Right now is a glorious church.
You might say, well, I've never been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Well, find out where the church is where people believe God and where they have the gifts of the Spirit in operation and people get healed and so on. And you'll find people that know how.
And Gloria, you've got a 24-hour prayer here.
We have 24-hour prayer.
Somebody could lead them into the baptism with the Holy Spirit.
If you want to receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit, call the prayer line and they'll help you and they'll give you some material to help you learn. I'm telling you, my spiritual life didn't go anywhere until I received the Holy Spirit. I got born again.
Yes.
I would have gone to heaven if I died early, but I didn't grow until after I received the Holy Spirit, baptism in the Holy
and
Spirit.
And God has asked us to pray this in.
Yeah.
And Jesus prayed in 17. That's really the Lord's Prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And He said, "Father, glorify Me." And He said, "The glory..." This is verse 22. This is John 17, verse 22. "The glory which You gave Me, I have given them, that they may be one as we are one." There's something about unity that brings the glory and the presence.
Allows the glory to come.
Remember how He said, no schism in the body.
That's right.
So the Lord is asking us now
to walk in love,
to pray together. This is, Sharon Doherty told me, "Billy, this is a way we can pray in unity."
That's right.
We can pray in the Holy Ghost in unity.
That's right.
And so He told me, make a 24-hour...
In the Spirit.
In the Spirit. Make a 24-hour prayer clock Get people to devote 30 minutes a day. Even you don't have to call us. You just do it. And you sit before the Lord and you say, here I am. I don't have an agenda, Lord. But you told me that if I pray in an unknown tongue, I'm praying your mysteries.
Praise God.
And here I am. I'm giving you my vessel, my tongue.
Thank you, Lord.
And you just start out, oh, Rataletino.
Glory to God.
He won't pass you by.
Amen.
He won't pass you by. He will use you to pray in the glory. And He will use you to stop the strategies of the enemy.
Amen.
Praise God.
Jesus is coming soon. We're going to be ready. And we're going to be that glorious church.
Yes, we are going to be the glorious church.
Glory to God. Billy and I'll be right back.
Do you want to get the most out of this teaching? We have you covered. Download your free copy of the easy-to-use study notes for today's broadcast on kcm.org/notes. Follow along with key teaching points, scriptures, faith-filled prayers, interactive questions, and more. Use them for your personal Bible study or to share with others. Go to kcm.org/notes and download yours now. We're here for you.
But we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory. The Bible says that as you gaze into the Lord's face by studying the Word and fellowshipping with Him, as you renew your mind to understand who you are in Christ, you'll be changed into His image on the outside as well. As you learn to hear His voice and obey it, you'll start giving outward expression of the glory within you. Instead of simply staring into your closet every morning, spend some time gazing at Jesus and beholding His Word. Little by little, you'll be turned inside out.
Calling all believers, God is raising up His church. He needs His people to stand and work with Him around the world through prayer in these end of days. The Prayer in the End of Days package will help equip you for that call. Kenneth E. Hagin's Bible Study Prayer Course is an easy-to-follow teaching that'll guide you through the ABCs of prayer. Your prayer life will grow as you watch Selected from the Secrets of Intercession 1983. In this one-of-a-kind DVD series, learn from Phil and Fern Halverson, Wilfred and Gertrude Wright, and others as they reveal to you the wisdom they received about the power of prayer. Over 30 years in the making, How You Can Pray in the End of Days is the latest book from Billy Brim. Concise and empowering, this book will teach you how to pray the plans of God into the earth, how to stop the strategies of the enemy everywhere, and how to pray for the nation of Israel. It's time for the body of Christ to unite in prayer and pray God's plan into our homes and our nations. Develop a stronger prayer life. Order the Prayer in the End of Days package today for only $49.95. Order your package at kcm.org/TV special or call 800-600-7395. You need wisdom to thrive in the end of days, and prayer is essential to tap into God's wisdom. The peace of God and the outpouring of His wisdom is made available through prayer. Order the Prayer in the End of Days package and walk in victory.
You might say, well, how do I get this authority? What do I do? Well, the first step is to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. He's the one that now has authority. Satan doesn't have authority. He steals everything he's got, and somebody let him steal it. We don't do that. We say, no, you don't, devil. You get your hands off my money. You get your hands off my children in the name of Jesus. So when you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you can operate in His name.
Yes, in His
what
name.
What an awesome thing, Billy. And that's the way people get born again. That's the way you prosper supernaturally. You make Jesus the Lord of your life. And you might think, well, I don't know. I couldn't do this anymore. I couldn't do that anymore. Listen, victory is so much better than anything you can get out there in the natural realm. You would be so happy. Hallelujah. Now, if you've never made Jesus the Lord of your life, just say, Jesus.
Jesus.
I receive you as my Lord and Savior.
I receive you as my Lord and Savior.
Take my life.
Take my life.
And do something with it.
And do something with it.
I receive you.
I receive you.
Amen.
Amen.
You know, I didn't know anything much about anything when I got born again, but I had a Bible. And that's exactly what I prayed. Take my life and do something with it. I had no clue that it would be this. But oh, thank God, I got in the plan of God for my life.
So begin walking in your new life. You have to stay in the Word of God to see what all belongs to you. It's awesome, the things that belong to you after you get born again and you're a member of the church.
Amen.
You're a member of the body of Christ. Glory to God. We have a free salvation package to help you. It's called He Did It All For You. It's two brochures how to study your Bible, a brochure on how to study your Bible. And so you request it free. We'll send you this salvation package. You can get it from kcm.org. Once you get born again, you'll keep walking in the darkness until you put Word in your eyes and in your ears, mm-hmm. and it gets in mm-hmm. your heart and it comes mm-hmm. out your mouth mm-hmm. in your authority. Glory mm-hmm. to God. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, partners, for your faithfulness. Kenneth Copeland Ministries sows at least 10% of every dollar you give into hundreds of other ministries around the world. This past year, you've helped to send over 1 million Bible studies to those in prison, over 17,000 teaching resources to those serving in the military, and food and medical supplies to families affected by Ebola. The list continues as God's love changes lives in our communities and nations. Together, we're doing greater works than ever before.
Today is offering day. Billy and I want to use our faith and believe God with you financially.
Yes.
This is a scripture for the sowers. Remember this, he who sows sparingly and grudgingly will also reap sparingly and grudgingly, and he who sows generously that blessings may come to someone will also reap generously and with blessings. Mm. This is 2 Corinthians 9:6, and this is verse 7. Let each one give as he's made up his own mind and purposed in his heart. So when it comes to any offering, you listen to God and do what he says and you'll come out right. Give not reluctantly or sorrowfully or under compulsion, for God loves. He takes pleasure in, prizes above all other things, and is unwilling to abandon a quick to do it. He's unwilling to abandon a quick to do it giver, a prompt to do it giver whose heart is in his giving. And God is able, there's no question about this, to make every favor, all grace, every favor and earthly blessing come to you in abundance so that you may always, under whatever circumstances, whatever's going into the world and happening around you, be self-sufficient and require no aid or support. And for any good work. So Billy and I go, we've just got a little bit of time. You get in with us and you believe God. Father, we pray for all the people listening to this broadcast. We pray and we come into agreement over their finances. Amen. In Jesus' name. Money, we command you to come to them, the money that they need to come to them in Jesus' name. You are able and we believe it. All grace comes to us. In the name of Jesus, we pray over the offering. We believe that as people sow, it shall be given back Amen. To them 100-fold. We believe, Father, and we thank you
thank you, Lord,
the people of God, the church of God, will never be destitute or without because you're our Father and we stand with you. We love you, Lord. We praise you. We sow. We're cheerful givers. Hallelujah. Billy, thank you for being
thank
with
you.
Us.
It's blessing.
Been so good.
Thank you for inviting me.
Be sure and let Billy know how much you've enjoyed it. And be sure and go to Prayer Mountain, check things out for the meetings, because they're awesome meetings up there. Glory to God. Ken and I go. We go and get in on it. So go to church this weekend. Get in your Bible every day. Read the Word of God and believe it. And next week, Dr. Caroline Leaf will be with us as our guest, and that is going to be great. She is amazing, an amazing woman. So be sure and listen next week. This is Gloria and Billy reminding you that Jesus is Lord.
Thank you for joining us today on the Believer's Voice of Victory. For this week's broadcasts on DVD or MP3 on CD, go to kcm.org. or call or write to us today. Remember this week's product offer. These ministry tools are designed to help you get the Word working in your life so you can experience all God has for you. If you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, be sure to request your free salvation package. This will help you understand who you are in Christ and how to start living your new life in victory.